Welcome back to Fox 8 News in the morning. While there is not yet a vaccine for COVID-19, today we're learning more about convalescent plasma as a treatment option. Dr. Stephen Filby, a cardiologist from University Hospitals, joins us now live. Doctor, thanks for being with us this morning. We've kind of covered this over the past few months, but just as a reminder, tell people at home what convalescent plasma is.
Thanks for having me, Kristi. Convalescent plasma therapy involves the administration of blood from someone who's recovered from an infection to an individual who is actively infected. The plasma portion of blood is the liquid portion. So the blood cells having been removed, there remains proteins and antibodies in the plasma that we think can be helpful to those patients that are succumbing or actively infected with an infection such as COVID-19.
Now, you've been involved in a study there at UH. The FDA has recently changed who can receive it. So what are the changes from what we are hearing a few months ago?
Prior to the FDA announcement of the EUA, there were two pathways in which patients could receive convalescent plasma. One in which was if the participating hospital or physicians were involved in a clinical trial, as we are at University Hospitals, and the other was through the expanded access pathway, which allowed a number of patients to receive plasma across the country. What this FDA announcement does is it makes it easier for patients and for physicians to prescribe plasma. Even through the extended access pathway, there was still some regulatory hurdles that physicians and hospitals had to go through. This announcement basically frees that up, and physicians can prescribe plasma now just as they would a medication.
Now, is this just for the worst of patients?
Yeah, this is okay. You know, this is a blood product. So there are risks involved with the transfusion of any blood product. Small risk, but still, there are some risks. Reactions to the blood, and then sometimes patients can have shortness of breath, and of course there are viruses that even though we screen for, can be transmitted with a transfusion. The FDA is recommending that plasma, convalescent plasma, only be considered in those patients that are very ill. So this is not a prophylactic or preventative. And this is not to be given for patients with milder forms of the disease or illness. But patients who have respiratory failure, hard work of breathing, patients who have heart injury, such as those who are included in our trial at University Hospitals, those patients we think would benefit the most from convalescent plasma, the patients that are the most ill.
For those who are watching right now and they want to help donate their plasma, how can they go about doing that and where can they go?
I would contact your local blood center.
Okay.
Not one of the things that we've learned through this trial is that not all blood centers are able to handle convalescent plasma, so contact your local blood center. Through this trial, we have partnered with Hawksworth in Cincinnati and also Vitalant. Of course, people are familiar with the American Red Cross. My expectation is that there might be blood drives as a result of this announcement that may allow patients or individuals who have recovered from the virus to donate more easily. This is a blood donation, and just even one patient can affect 2 to 3 individuals who are suffering from the virus.
Yeah, we're starting.
So this could be a real benefit for patients who are very ill.
Right. We're starting to get answers, and I think that gives a lot of people hope. We got to wrap this up, but talk real quick about how it can affect your heart. We've talked about this as well, but this is something that can happen maybe after recovery, right? So you're starting to recognize heart symptoms, and you said the ER is starting to pick back up with people actually recognizing their symptoms and coming to the ER.
Right. Well, there are two parts to that, really. Is one is we want patients who have any sort of cardiac symptoms, chest pain or shortness of breath, to seek appropriate medical care. This is not something that they should be staying at home or being confused about their symptoms. If they feel that they have symptoms, they need to go and seek emergency care. The other part of that question, Kristi, is that we've had two recent studies come out, published in JAMA, Journal of American Medical Association, that has indicated that, disturbingly, in patients who have recovered from COVID, even after 70 days, we're seeing some involvement in the heart, either inflammation or structural changes based on sensitive testing, such as MRI and blood tests. We don't know what the long-term ramifications of those changes are, but it is concerning, and we're keeping a close eye on it.
All right. Dr. Filby, thank you for being with us this morning. We appreciate it.
Thanks, Christine.